All right, man, we're going to have a great show tonight. It's hot down here in my home office. But we're here. Happy Father's Day to everybody. Happy Father's Day to everybody. We are making it do what it do. The phone lines are open. It's 818-850-5404. Where's a player's fan? I'm going to plug my fan up in a minute. I need some down in here. But we got a lot to talk about tonight, family. Glad to have everybody tuning in. If you have not gotten tickets to join me live, I'm going to be on tour starting next week. It starts in Philly, the Code of Conduct Tour. Here's the flyer again. Wait. The Code of Conduct Tour, family. It starts in Philly, July 5th, that's Sunday. We're going to be in Atlanta July 11th. That's a Saturday. Everybody get those tickets. A lot of people are rushing to get their tickets for Atlanta. It's going to be off the chisel. And I'm going to be in Detroit July 18th. That's another Saturday. I know they had some VIP tickets for the meet and greet. I think the VIP tickets in Detroit are sold out, but I think you can still get general seating. So all my Detroit people, go to TariqLive.com and get your tickets now. Let me give you the website again, www.TariqLive.com. Everybody, man, y'all need to come on out. If you're in New York, if you're in Baltimore, if you're in D.C. or whatever, you need to be in Philly. If you're close to Philly, Rhode Island, wherever you are, you need to be in Philly on the 5th. If you are in Florida, anywhere in Georgia, if you're in Alabama, if you're in Tennessee, especially if you're in South Carolina. We got a lot to talk about as far as South Carolina. But all you South Carolina brothers and sisters, y'all need to be down in Atlanta chopping up game with us on July 11th. We got a lot to talk about, a lot of work to do. Get your tickets now. Everybody who's in the South, if you're in Texas, come on over to Atlanta July 11th. It's a nice big venue because a lot of times I do venues in Atlanta and it gets so packed people have to stand up. We got a real big venue out there, so it's going to be nice and comfortable. I think we can squeeze in about 1,000 people in this venue. It's nice and big, so everybody come on out to Atlanta July 11th. Get your tickets now. Will the lecture be available for those? I don't know yet, Shay. But and also Detroit, if you're in Ohio, if you're in Milwaukee, you're in Chicago, come on up to Detroit on July 18th. But we got a lot to talk about tonight with all this stuff that's going on. I did a special show. What day was it? When they had the shooting, when the shooting happened with Dylan Roof, whatever his name is. How do you pronounce his name? Is it Roof or Ralph? Or Rolf? How do you pronounce that idiot's name? Thank you very much. He said you like the Tariq Elite shirts. Yeah, we got to talk about the situation that's going down in South Carolina. Like Roof, like the roof of a house, right? But I think they're having the funeral for the family. My heart goes out to the family. God bless the dead, the deceased. I think they're having the funeral this Tuesday in South Carolina. I haven't watched the news channels in the last couple of days. I just can't bring it upon myself to see all of that forgiving and singing and praying. I don't want to see no more of that bullshit. I'm done with watching that. I'm done with looking at all of the pathetic displays of forgiving and praying. It's so sad. It's so sick. It's so pathetic. And you will never get any respect being that passive. It has nothing to do with no Christianity. All of this forgiving and praying nonstop, it has nothing to do with nobody being a damn Christian. Because again, black folks, we will break a bottle on the curb and stab each other for the most minor petty bullshit. We don't forgive other black folks for nothing. You got World Star and all these video outlets that show black people beating the brakes off each other for looking at them wrong, for making a wrong comment on Twitter, for stealing their man, for stepping on their shoe, for not being from the same neighborhood. We beat each other down with no forgiveness, but the white supremacists, they will mow down your grandmothers. And y'all will line up talking about, I forgive you. Stop trying to blame that on some type of Christian value. God don't even respect you. I'm going that deep with it. God don't respect you black people for sitting up talking about you forgive Satan. Because that's what a person like that is. Because see, y'all can't have it both ways. You can't have it both ways. I saw some post today where they're talking about we're not going to let the devil win and the devil ain't going to come in our house and all that. But the devil came in your house and y'all forgave the devil. The devil came in your house and you forgave the devil. How are you forgiving the devil? Because Dylan Roof, that's Satan incarnated. What you think Satan look like? That's Satan. Satan ain't walking around in a red suit with ears and a pitchfork tail and all that shit. Satan is Dylan Roof and people who think like him. Those white extremists. What's up, sweetheart? All right. But that's what Satan is. Dylan Roof is Satan, and y'all line y'all black asses up in unison. I've been looking at black people on TV nonstop, forgiving Satan. God is looking at you real funny style. Because black folks are going to have to come to a decision. Are you going to worship God or are you going to worship Satan? Let's get spiritual tonight. Are you going to worship God or are you going to sit up and worship Satan? Because sitting up there forgiving Satan, because only a devil, ain't talking about race, I'm talking about action. Because I'm not doing the whole the white man is the devil thing. I don't do that because all white people are not racist, but you have a lot of people who are white supremacists. And I'm judging you based on your actions. I don't judge people based on what they're born like, because you have a choice. You have a choice. That Dylan dude made a choice. White supremacists, they make a choice. Because, see, black folks got to get off this other thing, too, talking about, oh, the white supremacy and racism, they're mentally ill. And No. Forget all that mental illness stuff. That's a choice. That Dylan dude made a choice to write a manifesto, get that gun, plan and plot to kill black people specifically. He made a choice. So black people, you got a problem, black folks. You've been bowing down to Satan for too goddamn long. And white supremacists, those are the devils. I ain't talking about white people are the devil. I'm talking about people who choose to practice an evil system, an unjust system called white supremacy. Those are Satan's incarnated. So this is why the same thing happens to us over and over. If we want to get real spiritual and metaphysical, which I don't like to touch on too much, but I'm trying to see what God are you worshiping where God explicitly did not want the devil around. God looked at devil as the devil as an enemy. And black people are sitting up here looking at Satan saying, I forgive you, Satan. Anybody who would go up in a church after you welcome him with open arms and kill grandmothers, that's you're looking at Satan. You don't forgive Satan. So black folks, y'all got it all the way fucked up I don't know what religion, that ain't no Christianity you preaching. And I put up a post on Facebook and Twitter, even in the Bible, book of John's chapter 2, verse 15, Jesus got a whip and ran evil people up out of the temple. Jesus whooped a little ass. Jesus had sense enough to know, hey, these people shouldn't be up in here. Jesus had sense enough, according to the Bible, to realize certain people don't need to be up around him. Go to John's chapter 2, verse 15, and look at that verse. Jesus knew this. Jesus didn't forgive everybody now. Jesus didn't give everybody a pass. Jesus said, hey, y'all don't need to be up in my temple with this bullshit. You don't forgive Satan. Because not only is this dude Satan, the dude, when you forgive people, you're supposed to forgive, from what I understand, you forgive people who are looking for forgiveness. You forgive people who look for forgiveness. That Dylan dude don't want no forgiveness. There's not a drop of remorse for this dude. There's no remorse in this dude's face. Have you seen this dude? He's walking around smirking. Mugging, there's not a drop of remorse with this dude. The dude don't have a drop of remorse. And you're forgiving somebody who don't even want to be forgiven? Do you know what Dylan said when he was shooting the people in that church? Because the police report came out. When Dylan was shooting those people, according to the police report, he said, I'm going to give you something to pray about. He said, I'm going to give you something to pray about. That ain't none but Satan incarnated. That's Satan, people. You always talk about the devil is a liar. The devil is a liar. The devil is a liar. Oh, Lord, the devil is a liar. Walk away, Satan. The devil is a liar. But how are you going to say the devil is a liar and you don't want Satan be gone and the devil? And then you sit up and forgive Satan. How you sit up and forgive Satan, black people? That is your problem, black folks. This is why spiritually, you think you jumping up and down and speaking in tongues, but you're speaking to the wrong God. You worshiping Satan and you're forgiving Satan because now you're afraid. You've lost faith in the real God, in the melanoid God, the God who created melanoid people first. I feel like Reverend Tariq right now. There's a reason why God made melanoid people first. And for melanoid people to bow down and to praise white supremacy is an act of disrespect and defiance to the melanoid God. I'm going to talk a lot about this when I go on my tour. Y'all need to come out because we're going to have some real talk. We're going to break this thing down economically, spiritually, physically, socially. We're going to break this thing down. I'm going to make it real plain. I'm going to make it real plain. Y'all bowing down to Satan. Every time y'all sit up here talking about, y'all look at Satan. You look at the George Zimmermans talking about, I forgive you. Trayvon Martin's mother, bless her heart, but she sat up there forgiving George Zimmerman. Y'all sit up and co-sign these goddamn demons. You sit up and co-sign demons. And then you wonder why your blessings do not get answered. You wonder why we keep going in the same circle. Y'all definitely going to want to come to the lecture, man. I'm going to be real raw with it. I'm going to get real raw with this thing. These white supremacists are not playing. Because what happens when these news outlets coerce a lot of black folks into talking about forgiveness, what you're doing, the white supremacists, and understand this, the white supremacists all work together. Let me quote me on this. there is no such thing as a lone wolf white supremacist. There is no such thing as a lone wolf white supremacist. The reason why the white supremacists do what they do and the white extremists do what they do is because they understand they have a network of people who are going to co-sign them and support them in some shape, way, form, or fashion. They know that they have other cops that's going to support them somewhere. They have other judges. They have other people who will send them money. Just like with this Dylan guy, people are waiting to send him money. There's already support pages all over the place for him that we've had to get taken down off Facebook. So there's already a support system for this Dylan dude. The white supremacists, there's no such thing as a lone wolf white supremacist. By definition, they understand that they have a group of people who are going to support him. And the media is included. They also know the media is going to have their back, and the media is going to have sympathy towards them. They already know that. The white supremacists, they all have an understanding. So, but this Dylan dude, he knows, even through osmosis, that the media will get black people and make them forgive him and put them on TV saying, I forgive, I forgive, I forgive. So now this taints a jury. If a jury is watching, or potential jurors, they've seen all of these black folks sit up here and say, I forgive, I forgive, I forgive. So now any potential white juror is going to be like, well, hell, I should forgive him too. Also, the white supremacists know that they have judges that's part of the religion of white supremacy. Did y'all see what the judge said? That judge, the judge that they had for this Dylan dude, they had to take him off the case. The judge got up here talking about, well, you know, there's victims on both sides. You know, this is a tragedy for both sides. The judge sound like a lawyer for Dylan. The judge was using all types of little code words. The judge sounded like a lawyer for Dylan. We should have sympathy for his family too, his family of victims. Like, what? I mean, when have you heard ever of a black person killing anybody and you go to court and people start talking about the killer's families are victims too? You ain't never heard that. That nigga's family be right there in court getting charged with being accessories to the murder. You don't sit up and say that his people are victims. Our whole family would get charged. Also, that same judge, they had to take him off the case because he was using the word nigga in court. He used the word nigga in court. So they had to hurry up and take him off that case. There's no such thing as a lone wolf white supremacist, man. These white supremacists work in groups. And then they found the dude's manifesto and the whole nine yards. We're in here deep tonight. We're in here like 1,500 people. Shout out to everybody in the room. Shout out to the room. But they're already trying to create an atmosphere to get this killer the most lenient sentence possible. They're trying to get this dude already. The white supremacists are working hard, trying to get him the most lenient sentence ever. The manifesto was heavy. Let me say this. Go to melanoidnation.org to read his manifesto, because this guy put up a manifesto in the whole nine yard. From reading his manifesto, it sounds like some other groups of people are working with this dude and they're not saying nothing. That's one reason why they don't want to call him a domestic terrorist, because there's some other people working with this dude. I've said on Facebook or in Twitter, I wouldn't be surprised if law enforcement somehow was working with this dude, because you got law enforcement who's working with a lot of these white supremacist groups. But that manifesto, that sounds like some shit that some white supremacist organization is working with him. Because the thing is, this dude, for a motherfucker who dropped out on the ninth grade, the dude only has a ninth grade education. He's real articulate in that damn manifesto he wrote. for a motherfucker who done dropped out of school in the ninth grade, he's real articulate with that manifesto. So who is he getting all that from? For a motherfucker who done dropped out of the ninth grade. So I'm thinking there's some white supremacist groups that's working with this dude on the low, and they just kind of let him be the fall guy. They martyred this guy. That manifesto was deep. It was deep. But it sounds like he's working with some type of organization. But they're trying their best to make this sentence as lenient as possible with this guy. Y'all got to understand how white supremacists work. Because y'all notice they will not label this guy a domestic terrorist. And if you look at the definition of terrorist, they say, well, it's somebody who's targeting a specific group. He's targeting black folks. Or a terrorist is somebody who has a political agenda. Dylan killed a politician. The reverend that he killed is a sitting senator, a councilman. So, but he killed a politician. The reverend was a politician. How is that not domestic terrorism? Everything about that is terrorism. Everything about it was pre-planned. He had a manifesto. This dude targeted and cased out these people for the longest. So everything about this dude was terrorism. And also that bail. That's another thing too. That judge gave him that low-ass bail. But the thing is, he gave him a low bail on the gun charge. That judge would have given him another low bail on those murder charges. But according to the law, he couldn't get bail on that because it's the law. That's the only reason the judge didn't give a bail on the actual murder charges, because it's the law. You can't give bail on the murder charges. But that $1 million bail was actually very low for that gun charge. That ain't shit. Hell, Suge Knight is in jail for running somebody over in a car. His bail is $20 million or $25 million. Hell, Bobby Smurda is in jail and his bail is $1 million. He didn't shoot nobody. Bobby Smurda is in jail right now and didn't shoot nobody. And his bail is $1 million. That bail is for the gun only. That's true. But this is another thing y'all ain't catching. Y'all know why they keep on talking about hate crime, hate crime, hate crime, hate crime. They keep repeating hate crime. Oh, this is a hate crime. They immediately came out and said it was a hate crime. You notice they had no problem saying it was a hate crime. Even before they caught him, they started saying hate crime. The police chief came out. Yep, this is a hate crime. Yep, the feds came out. We're going to investigate a hate crime, hate crime, hate crime. You know why they kept saying hate crime and will not say domestic terrorism? They keep saying hate crime, and this goes over people's head because you don't know the law. They keep repeating the word hate crime because there are 5 states in the United States that don't have hate crime laws. Most of the states have hate crime laws. There's 5 states that don't. One state is, I think, is Arkansas. One state is Indiana. One state is Wyoming. One state is Georgia, and the other state is South Carolina. What a damn coincidence. South Carolina don't have no hate crime law, family. They ain't telling you this. Look it up if you think I'm bullshit. That's why they keep saying hate crime, because there is no hate crime law in South Carolina. They don't have a hate crime law. So if they go to court and say, okay, we charge him for a hate crime, all they're going to do is say, okay, well, not guilty, because there ain't no hate crime law in California. It's not against the law to do a crime based on hate. So they will immediately dismiss that. They setting this shit up, dude. Ain't no hate crime law in South Carolina, man. That's why they keep repeating it, because they know it's going to get dismissed the minute it goes to court. These white supremacists are not playing, man. They can dismiss that shit just like that, dude. Watch what they do. when they start giving up information a little bit too easy, because they start throwing that hate crime shit out there real fast. And wait, think about it. And I say, wait, that don't look right. They keep throwing that hate crime out there. Because when have they really volunteered that? Because whenever white supremacists kill black folks, it's always, well, we got to investigate. We got to wait for the evidence to come in. We got to get all the facts. You hear that all the time. Well, we saw Walter Scott get shot in the back by a cop, but we still need to see more evidence. We need to wait till the facts come in. They don't just start throwing out shit like that for nothing. But the minute this dude shot all those people, hate crime, hate crime, hate crime, because hate crime don't mean shit in South Carolina, so they can say it until they're blue in the face. And niggas out here sitting up praying and hugging and holding hands and all that. And these white supremacists are running all types of game behind your back, man. These white supremacists are running all... They're setting this shit up to give this dude the lightest sentence they can find. Man, y'all better watch this case closely. It's not open and shut. This is not an open and shut case. These white supremacists are working hard behind the scene. Because first they were trying to go for the he's mentally ill angle. They were already setting that up. And the news and all these media outlets, they're going to help them. They were first trying to go for the mentally ill thing, but when you look at the manifesto, this dude carefully thought out what he was going to do. So you can't use the temporary insanity thing. This dude carefully planned out what he was going to do. Then they tried to say the drug thing. Well, he has a history of drug use and all that. Can't do the drug use thing because, again, this dude planned this thing over a period of time. So it wasn't like he was just on some high drug binge. He planned this thing. Then they deflect. Well, it's about guns. We got too many guns out here. The white supremacists are never going to give up their guns. Never, ever, ever, ever. They're not going to give up their guns. They ain't letting no gun laws pass that's going to take their guns from them at all. Now, they'll get some race-based gun laws because when you go get a gun, there is a what's your ethnicity, what race are you when you go get a gun license. They want to know what your race is. That's not a coincidence that they do that. Yeah, they're trying to portray him as a child in the whole nine. But they're going to try to give this dude the most lenient sentence that they can give him. And they done brought out the coons. Did y'all see that interview with his so-called one of his black friends? I'm going to play that interview with one of his so-called black friends. And that's another thing, man. These news outlets, they're bringing in all the coons they can find to kind of co-sign this dude and try to make it seem like he wasn't racist. Let me play this interview they did of his so-called black friend. And this is another thing, black folks. Y'all got all these people around you, these white supremacists saying little slick stuff, making little slick jokes, and y'all sit up and let them do it. And this is how they really think about you. And a lot of y'all don't even care because a lot of you coons, you try to be little de facto white supremacists when you get around these people. And if they end up blowing your brains out, then y'all going to be somewhere looking crazy. But this is the so-called black friend of Dylan. Now, this dude hated black people. And black folks got to understand this. Just because somebody who's a suspected white supremacist is up in your face skinning and grinning, behind closed doors, they can have some extreme views about you. Because white supremacy is not all about somebody being mean to you on a day-to-day basis. It's about a systematic practice. But look at this coon who's supposed to be Dylan Roof's friend.
Where did he stop? When he was here, he would just...
He'd be sleeping right here.
Sure. I'll show you guys the Dylan light. The Dylan light.
So he would just crash out?
Yeah, just like that.
What's your reaction to the news about Dylan?
Like, that he actually did everything he said he was going to do.
And I don't feel no different today than I felt about him before he did this stuff. Like I said, who's to say Dylan was in his right mind? Nobody knows what anybody go through.
Was Dylan ignorant? Was he racist?
No. Like, everybody's making him out to be racist, but here I am in front of you today as a black man and telling you I look at him no different today than what I looked at him last week. Because he never said anything racist to me, never treated me any different than he treated Justin.
You said at the beginning of the interview that at one point he might have said something, but you didn't remember it. What did you mean by that?
Like he told us that he was not, that church wasn't his primary target at all. That's why my heart goes out to those non-families, because you guys weren't the targets.
What does that mean?
He wanted to shoot that school up, UCA, University of Charleston. It's 3 miles up the street from that church.
He told you.
Yeah,
he wanted to attack the school.
Yeah, he had no intentions on harming those people in that church.
Can you just tell me more about when he told you this?
We're on our way to the river. It was on a Wednesday because we dropped them off at the lake. So he was like, he's going to shoot the school up. And I was like, what? And he just stopped talking about it. He never said anything else about it. He was just like, they all got 7 days to live. Who knows? Like, how many friends do you have that's killed 9 people within this week? So how do you take it serious?
As close as possible, can you remember what words he used to say what he said?
That I'm gonna shoot the university up, and they all got 7 days to live. On Wednesday he did it. He shot that church up.
Did he give you a reason as to why he said he might want to do that?
No reason. I think it all boils down to his childhood. Him and his parents aren't on good terms. Like I said, without the support of your parents, you'll do things that you wouldn't think you do.
When he mentioned the school, did he have a grudge against the school in the past?
None.
Or anything like that?
I don't even know if he knew anybody at the school. Like, he had no grudge. He wasn't an angry person.
And he never mentioned the church before either?
Never. Like, I've never heard him say anything racist. I've never heard him say anything about hurting black people, and specifically black people only. Not once.
Where did he...
All right, y'all saw this little buck dancing coon. Now, let me say this. Dylan, now he said, well, Dylan did say some racist, but I forgot. Now, you forgot that. Dylan was probably saying all types of little racist stuff around this coon, but this coon is so white supremacist minded, he probably sat up there giggling and agreeing with him. He probably sat up there agreeing with them, because that little coon right there, he's one of those little Negroes who think that he's in with the white supremacists. So he think he's just a little dark-skinned white supremacist himself. He's one of them little weird niggas. And I went to his Facebook page, one of his pages. He had a little white girlfriend in the whole nine. And I'm not knocking anybody's interracial relationships, but he's one of those little clown-ass niggas. You know, these little skateboarding Hootie and the Blowfish-ass niggas you see out here. That one black dude with all the white friends talking whiter than them. He's the little entertainment Negro. You understand? Why that he's the butt of the joke, but he don't know that he's the butt of the joke. Those type of little Negroes. And just because a white supremacist is sitting around you acting like your friend and sitting up writing manifestos about you, that don't mean that they accept you. The other white boy knew how to keep his mouth shut. The other white kid next to him, that white boy was sticking to the code. I ain't saying shit. The other white boy was sticking to the code of white supremacy. He wasn't saying nothing. It's this little coon running his mouth trying to get brownie points. This little coon trying to get brownie points. He wasn't racist to me. He didn't say nothing racist to me. I don't look at him no different. He just shot up a church full of black folks. Then wrote a manifesto talking about black people ain't shit and black people should die and the white race rules and we need segregation and apartheid. A coon is sitting up here talking about, I don't look at him no different. Y'all got to understand, when I say I'm not here to save everybody, that nigga right there is what I mean by me not here to save everybody. People come to me like, damn, Tariq, man, I got a cousin, uncle, man, they ain't getting it. Fuck them. I ain't trying to convert a nigga like that. We need to understand when niggas are gone. When niggas are lost. There's lost niggas out here, dude. Leave these lost niggas lost. Once you find out when somebody identifies themselves as a lost nigga, have a good day, sir. Go on over there and do what you gotta do. Don't come in my mix. We spend a lot of time trying to recruit these people and let them see the light. These dudes are like zombies. It's like the Walking Dead. They've turned. They are walkers. They've turned. You can't do nothing with a walker. That's what the Walking Dead is really about. But the reverse side with the white supremacists. It's about white survival and dealing with people who are turned. Turned meaning people who are sympathetic to black plight. Y'all got to look at the metaphors in some of this stuff. Some of these niggas, they've been bitten. I don't want to hear no crispy logic. No crispy logic. Y'all, shame on you niggas for sitting up here listening to known coons. Listening to pathological liar coons who would do anything for attention and coon money. Shame on you. But you got to understand this. Well, black folks, when we see all this injustice going on, we are deep in here, man. We're heavy. We almost got 2,000 people. Y'all better go to TariqLive.com, all you 2,000 people. TariqLive.com. Go to TariqLive.com. And get tickets to join me on tour. Wherever you are around the country, make it to one of those cities. Make it to one of those cities, family. But the thing is, you know, with black folks, because I talked about this the other day, black people have no other excuses. Black people have no other excuses, and you don't want to deal with white supremacy head on. And when it's hitting you in the face, then people start talking about, let's just pray. Because black folks, you can't use the excuse, well, you should have just pulled your pants up. Well, you shouldn't have been mouthing off at the cop. You shouldn't have been doing this. Now, the white supremacists then came up in a church and killed black folks. So now you got to deal with white supremacy. So only thing you can do is say, well, the Lord is going to handle it. I'm going to pray. That's called cowardice. And also with these white supremacists out here, these media outlets, understand this. The name of the game for them is to be in denial, no matter what. They keep trying their best to spin this shooting. Fox News was talking about this was an attack on Christians. They keep trying to ignore that this was white supremacy, full on, head on, and that's why the dude did it. And that's why he did it the way he did it. Because he wanted people to know, I'm not talking in code. I'm done with talking in code. This is white supremacy, straight up and down. And that's what they want. They want to be in a position where they can stop talking in code and just be their old racist selves. They're tired of talking in code. And the thing is with black people, the white supremacists, they understand you. They understand you. They know what makes you tick. They know what can pacify you. They know what you like. They know how to calm the savage beast. The white supremacists know all they have to do to calm you down, Negroes, is go down to Charlotte or go down to Ferguson or go down to Baltimore and just basically send a few white people down there to hug you. Hold your hand, march with you for a couple of hours, and then everything will be all right. The people in the dominant society, they're out there right now in Charlotte hugging Negroes. Oh, this was such a tragedy, and black folks are eating that shit up. Black folks are eating them hugs up because that's what you really, really wanted. That hug is better than justice. Hugs from white people, that's your justice. All they got to do is go pat you on that little head of yours. Say, oh, that was so horrible. I'm going to march with you hand in hand. Come on, let's all join hands like good Christians and march. And then what happens, and Neely Fuller talked about this, they'll go out there, they'll march with you, hug you, kiss you on your little chocolate cheeks, eat some sweet potato pie with you, sing some Negro spirituals with you for a couple of days, and then go right back home and go right back to business as white supremacy. White supremacy will go back to business as usual. Nothing will change. They will go down there and hug you and pacify you and go right back to practicing white supremacy on your ass, and everything is back to normal. Nothing has changed. Nothing. Nothing has changed. Not one thing has changed. Nothing has changed. They have no problem going down there temporarily bullshitting with you, consoling you, and then going right back to maintain the system of white supremacy. And y'all fall for it every damn time. And then you get killed again. They come, oh, no, 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 no. Oh, they didn't mean it now. The Lord knows your heart. All we need is some forgiveness. I forgive them. Okay, well, I'm going to go back to my suburb that you can't come in because we'll shoot your black ass too. But next time it happens, I'm going to come down here to the ghetto and hug you. And y'all fall for that okey-doke. They don't give a shit about what happens. They just want to pacify you because they know that will pacify you. We need change. We need federal protection. Black folks need land. We need sovereignty. We need a whole bunch of shit to rectify this situation. There's a lot of stuff. If you ain't talking about some real solutions, when I'm talking, that's why y'all come see me live. We're going to talk about some real solutions. I ain't talking about no hugs and all that old sucker shit. Because if y'all come around me and people in the dominant society say, well, Tariq, what can I do? Oh, I got a whole laundry list on what you can do. Come on out and see me live so I can break it down for those in the dominant society. I got a laundry list of what you can do. I ain't talking about coming out there hugging people for a couple of days. I got a list of shit that you can do if you really want to get this thing fixed and settled and rectified. I don't want no hugs from nobody. Don't hug me and then I got to go back to watching my back before a cop comes shoot me. Let's see who's on the phone. What's up? Who's calling?
This is Carrington. How you doing?
Hey, man. How you doing? Where you calling from, brother?
I'm calling from Boston.
Boston. Okay. What's on your mind, man?
I was calling because I did have a little bit of contention regarding how you talked about the black church. I think that as a student of black liberation theology, I think there's a lot of big churches who are doing a lot to address systematic white supremacy.
Such as who? Which ones?
I mean, there's a lot of churches across the country. I can't name any specific ones.
Well, damn, brother, you can't name them. That kind of proves the point, don't it? Because you should be able to rattle them things off back to back to back to back. Because the thing is, brother, we can't be playing games with this thing. We got to know who's who and who's what and where we can go to have sanctuary or to go to get empowerment. Because right now, these people are running up in these churches shooting people now. And there was a copycat dude who was running up in another church out there in Virginia. So, and also there was another situation where somebody shot at a black church in Memphis. So these white supremacists are waiting to start getting their vigilante war on. So it can't be about, well, I know something, but I don't know it offhand. You got to know what the fuck is going on so we can start acting on it, brother.
Part of it, what I say that they're addressing white supremacy is that they're doing a lot to uplift black individuals and communities. And there's churches across the country. From Boston to Ohio.
Brother, I'm not talking about giving a scholarship to Pookie to go to Job Corps, all that. No, I'm talking about collective, brother.
People who are partnering with organizations to uplift black people. So I appreciate your show. I think because it was a great documentary. I saw all three of them.
Okay, brother. Thank you. Thank you so much, brother. Thank you, brother. Okay, because when people start saying, okay, I love your stuff. Okay, now you're deflecting. Okay, thank you so much, brother. But when people start going to this, well, oh, I love your documentary and all that, now you're deflecting, brother. I'm trying to get to the point. We need some tangible solutions. You don't have to praise me. I want to help everybody else collectively. That's my thing. Where do we go? If you know a church that's doing all this stuff, where is it? Well, I don't know it offhand. Well, brother, you're wasting my time and you're wasting everybody else's time. Do you understand that? We play too many games here. My man start, and I'm not trying to shit on you, brother, but we're going to have to start getting our code of conduct. And our code of conduct is going to have to be about us not just throwing out slogans and catchphrases. Well, there's some churches out there that's doing certain things for the community. Who? What? Give me some specifics, man. Who? Well, I don't know none offhand. Okay, what they doing? Well, they doing good things in the community. All these vagaries and slogans, fuck that. We don't need that. We got to get very specific about what we need to do, man. I'm not trying to shit on my brother, but we waste too much time playing. That's why I respect the Nation of Islam. That's why I respect the Nation of Islam, because they understood the game. A person like Dylan couldn't walk up in a Nation of Islam church. You understand? That's why I respect them. People complain or say whatever, but I respect them because they understand where we are and what we need to do. You're not walking up in the Nation of Islam's church because, number one, they're going to frisk you. Hell, they frisk black folks, which they should. So they're going to frisk you. If Dylan showed up at the Nation of Islam's church or temple, oh no, they would have got his ass up out of there. See, that goes up to us knowing what the hell is going on and not being blinded by the love of the white supremacist. You understand? The white supremacists, they're going to hit you in your weak points. Let's see who we got on the phone, man. What's up? Who's calling?
This is Lewis from New Jersey. I want your take on this. Right after the shooting, you had Obama get on TV now trying to push these gun restrictive laws.
Yeah.
He mentioned that in his speech. Do you think because of the shooting now and the government thinks that now black people are going to arm themselves, that now this is the excuse really to get hard on these gun laws?
They're not going to get hard on gun laws because the white supremacists out here, they're not going to allow that to happen. These NRA people, these people are very serious about their guns. The white supremacists will never give up their guns because that's the only way they can maintain control over melanoid people is through weaponry. They're never going to give them guns up at all. So that's just empty rhetoric. To me, that's just a deflection to get away from white supremacy, to get out there talking about it's a gun thing. It's not a gun thing because they ain't shooting up no white churches. So that was nothing but a deflection, which is always what they do. I saw something on MSNBC where they got a whole bunch of black people who were in jail for shooting people and tried to kind of correlate that with this Charleston shooting, basically as a deflection. The MSNBC, who's supposed to be liberal, they did that. So these white supremacists are all working in conjunction with each other to take the focus off white supremacy because the international community, they're looking at this like, okay, America has a major race problem they ain't doing nothing with. So America keeps trying to, my dogs are barking upstairs. America's trying to make it into some other shit. I'll have you call back, brother. Hold on. What the fuck is my dog? Okay, my dog is upstairs barking. But yeah, whenever Obama says something at this point, you know, you got to bow your head. You got to bow your head in shame because it's so weak looking. Now, do you know the prime minister, the Israeli Minister of Treasury, some guy, it was an Israeli politician's wife, made a racist tweet about Obama. I think it was yesterday or today. Her name is Judy Moses. Now, she's the wife of an Israeli prime minister, or politician, big-time politician over there, a head of state. And Judy Moses, and she said real slick stuff about Obama before. Now, this is the wife of a head of state now. This is a wife of a head of state. And understand this. When that Charlie Hebdo, that situation happened in France where those Muslims shot up the Charlie Hebdo newspaper headquarters, killed all them white French people, heads of state around the world all got together arm in arm supporting each other. Now, 9 black folks then got shot in the church by white supremacists, and instead of all the world heads of states getting together against these white supremacists, these heads of states are out here making racial jokes on Twitter about Obama. That Judy Moses said a joke, her joke was, Obama's like a cup of coffee, black and weak. That's a real heavy diss. When other people who are heads of state, the interior ministers, okay, when heads of state and their mates are sitting up here calling you weak, that says a lot. That really says a lot. Not only have they not band together in support of what's happening against these white supremacists, they're sitting up making racial jokes. And Israeli is real funny style. Israel, no wonder the Ethiopians are catching hell over there. The white supremacists all have the same mindset. And the reason why they look at Obama as being weak is because of the way he's allowing people who look like him to be treated. Nobody respects brother, man. Nobody's respecting. These heads of states and all these people, they're disrespectful to him because people look at how you treat your own. All the coons out here, they'll sit up and laugh and joke around you. Let me talk to the coons directly. But the white supremacists, they despise the coons. They secretly despise coons. They use you for what they can use you for because they know you're silly and stupid. They use you for what they can use you for, but they look at you like, this nigga right here. I wouldn't trust this nigga as far as I can throw a stick at him. If he will turn on his own people, he'll turn on me. They have no respect. That's like somebody who's, they treat you good, but they beat their children. You don't respect somebody who beat their children or who abused their children. No matter what they do, if you see they're beating their children, you don't respect that. You treat your own people like that, you don't respect that. You dig? So they show the ultimate forms of disrespect to President Barack Obama. Because they see how he handles the situation with black people getting slaughtered and not saying anything. Zero respect for that. What's up? Who's calling?
Hey, Terry. This is Tia. Can you hear me?
What's your name, sweetie?
Tia.
Tia, where are you calling from?
Yes, I'm calling from Arizona. I'm going to put your live stream on pause so I can hear you better.
Yes, indeed. So what's going on in Arizona?
Okay, really not much. Everything is really cool. A lot of people aren't really commenting on what's going on in Charleston. Really how I was informed about it was on my Facebook. Yeah. And then I started following this lady. Her name is Sister Solove.
Oh, yeah.
And she's out. Have you heard about her?
I heard about her. Yeah.
Okay, and I just wanted to see your take on how she's, you know, doing her activist thing out there and engaging the public and talking about it, because she's getting a lot of flack behind it.
She is.
And I kind of support her movement, really.
Now, why do you support her movement, by the way?
Well, because I just feel like history is kind of repeating itself with all of our, you know, people just getting gunned down and same thing is happening. We go and we colonize and console each other and hug on each other and pray for one another, but yet the same thing keeps on happening. So it's just like, something has to be done different in order for us to see a change. I'm totally with the movement about, you know, keeping the dollar in the black community and, you know, supporting black businesses, but it's just like everyone is not on one accord.
Okay.
So it's just like, how do you get ears and eyes to just hear you and stand out?
Right.
And then now that she's doing it and she's being a voice for a lot of us, she's getting a lot of flag behind
She should. I think she should, because the thing is, I saw her. Like when Don Lemon was talking, she was like, she had a sign up saying black, angry black woman and such, Don Lemon's a coon, Uncle Tom. And that was entertaining. Okay, I'm like, okay, now, you know, she's trying to do something. But you got to understand that sometimes people will mix in a message for their own personal gain. And it looks like she might be on some attention whoring shit. Because when they finally started interviewing her, she she mixed in some decent stuff, but she was mixing it in with some stupid shit. And that's my thing. You can't be mixing the messages together because now you're starting to look like an agent provocateur. And she starts saying some stuff. She got off code, doing a lot of name calling and stuff like that will work against us. That's not going to work. And then it started looking like, okay, she's just out here trying to get some attention. And also, I did a little research on her. And let me, I'm going to play some videos of her so people can understand who she is. But listen in and thanks for the call. But there's this woman named Sister Solove, who's the angry black woman. Now, they finally interviewed her because she's all trying to get attention, trying to get attention, trying to get attention. And from what I understand, she put up a GoFundMe page. All right? But I'm going to play some a video of her talking. And some of it was deep. She was saying some real stuff, but then it got into some ignorant shit that it's like, okay, now you're giving the white supremacists ammo. And then when you look into her background, find out she used to be a stripper. And that's another thing. We got all these people out here, just like with that chick who was trying to expose Umar, all of these former strippers and these people with these nefarious backgrounds coming up trying to be the mouthpiece for the Black Progress Movement. You got to watch some of these people. These people who pop up out of nowhere, who stripping and they got Fed charges and all that, and then all of a sudden they're trying to speak out or come around people who are trying to get the black thing going. Now let me, this is this Sister Solove right here.
Somebody you know have called us niggers. It's just the truth. These words are not just made up belief words. These are words that have been going around for years. So let's deal with the hate. We cannot go anywhere unless we deal with the hate and look it in the face. Period.
Do you have any white friends?
I know white people. I'm not a racist. I'm just an angry black woman. And the fact of the matter is, from my people and my standpoint, black kids, black youth are angry. They're mad. Why you see all the riots going on everywhere? It's not happening here because it's more of an older city and town. You understand? So it's ran by elders. But the young youth, they're preparing. Right. Please believe, they are preparing.
Are you promoting the preparation?
I'm promoting that I'm angry. That's why I'm here.
No violence, you know?
I'm angry. What do we do with the anger? Do you have an answer for that? Do you have an answer for that? What am I supposed to do with the anger? What do I do? Thank you. So until you have an answer to that, the questions you're asking is irrelevant.
So you justify violence? Is that what you're saying?
I am not sitting here justifying anything but anger. It's there. And Charleston and everywhere else in the world needs to wake up to the anger of the black people and the white people that are racist in this country. Period. Because it's there.
What do you do with it?
That's what I just asked you. What do we do? As black people, what do we do with the anger? No, we're angry. We're angry with white America.
And I'm going to play some more of this, but she ain't saying nothing, man. She's not saying shit. She's really just out there trying to get attention at this point, man. That's really embarrassing to watch this. That's why they got all the cameras on her now. When they put all those cameras on you, now they're like, oh, we got a good one. We're going to use this for what we can use it for. She's not saying nothing deep. We're angry. We're just angry. Well, what do you do with it? What do you do? I don't know. She sounds ignorant now, dude. Now she's sounding like an agent provocateur now.
We're angry. That's what I'm trying to tell you. That's where black on black crime comes from. We can't harm you, so we harm each other. So we're killing each other. We're angry. You think a black boy that kills another black boy is happy? Ooh, that's a good question, isn't it? Think about it, sir. Think about it. It's anger. It's anger from our history. It's anger from because white people like you have cameras in my face making this a joke and you're smiling. Nothing about this is funny. Nothing about this is funny, so I'm done talking to you, cracker.
So now they're smiling because they're laughing at her because she's ignorant, man. They're laughing and they eating it up. They're out there filming her. They're laughing at her because they know she looks ignorant. They're going to eat this up. She's just saying the same thing. She's not deep. She's not really breaking anything down. So this woman could be an agent provocateur, man.
Thank you. So yeah. I can't ask a question
anymore? No, I'm done because you're smiling and there's nothing funny about it. Okay. I'm angry. Until you're mad like me, you can leave me alone.
Is there a couple standing there because you just used the racial slur?
Cracker? It's
It's a word. It's the word. Do you identify crack as a bad word?
I think some
do. You know where crack come from?
Some
do you know what cracker comes from?
Sister, what's your last name?
Do you know what cracker comes from? Do you know where the word cracker comes from? Do you know?
I ate a Cracker Barrel once. I thought it was pretty good.
And once again, laughing. This is the problem.
I've answered your
question.
You're
laughing at the anger.
This isn't a skin color.
And this is the exactly. But this one's laughing. And this is why I don't like that. Period, point blank. I'm angry. Deal with that. And not understand that I'm not the only one that's angry.
I just don't understand why it feels like what you said. It's every white person's problem. You like made a blanket statement.
It
so
is. It is. We're done. I'm done.
But you,
I'm
what,
done.
You have white friends, though, man. Even are your white friends racist?
You don't know how people feel behind closed doors, do you? Do you think that this white boy that killed 9 people just woke up all of a sudden one day and said, "I just want to kill black people"? Answer the question. 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 Well, I'm done. I'm done talking to you, two crackers. I'm done talking to you, two crackers. Sorry.
You
can't answer my question, but you want me to answer yours. I'm done talking to you, cracker. Excuse me?
Can you give us your real name, please?
Sister Sola. That's all you're going to get, cracker.
I'm a cracker.
Wow.
And I'm a nigga.
That's cool.
And I'm a nigga.
No, you're not.
No, I am. No, I am. No. It's okay. You say that. You say it behind closed doors. You do.
How do you know what I say behind closed doors?
You do. You all do. You all do. Please.
Now, she out here talking about, you a cracker, I'm a nigga. She don't represent us, dude. And I'm going to keep playing it because, see, people, we got to know who's out here. See, the young lady called up like, ooh, I'm following her. This is why, man, you got to really know who's out here and what they're really about. You can't follow this, dude. She's like, oh, you're a cracker and I'm a nigger. Come on, dude. That's embarrassing.
Get off of me, please. Get off of me. Please.
I think you just gave Mr. Root power.
Good. Good. Still angry. Not gonna change anything right now.
I'll pray for you.
Don't pray to me, because I don't pray to white Jesus at all. He ain't gonna help save nothing. White Jesus ain't gonna save nothing.
You understand that? You see that? So stuff like that. She could be an agent provocateur going out there with that ignorance, man. Because that gives the Fox News people ammo. They can be out there talking about, well, the protesters were calling us crackers. So all she did was just give them ammo out there acting ignorant. You understand? That's all she was doing. Whoa. Oh, Epic, let me ban you. There you go. Had to ban you, Epic. There you go. It was very hard to watch. Now, this is another video of her from a few months ago admitting to being a stripper. Hold on.
What's good, everybody? It's your girl, So Love, and the So Love Factor is back each and every Sunday night, 8 p.m. Eastern Time, okay? So make sure you set your time clock, set your phones, whatever you got to do, because you don't want to miss the show tonight. Tonight's show is all about strippers. Yeah, man. It's all about, I'm in love with them strippers, honey. Let me tell you, a lot of people are infatuated with dancers. The whole world, it seems like every state, every city you go to, there's all kind of strippers, and famous strippers are getting married to rappers and athletes and becoming movie stars, reality show stars, radio personalities. Yes, your girl So Love you. Used to be a dancer, and I'm going to show you a video that has been going around. Rumors have been going around about me being a dancer, so I'm going to put all the rumors to rest tonight on the show tonight. But I want to give you
So again, this woman, man, she used to be in the game. She used to be in the sex industry. Used to be a stripper. She got a video, some old footage of her, and she. I don't know how old this woman is. She could be over 40. I don't know. Seems like she got some miles on her. This is a video of her clapping her butt cheeks. This is Sister Soul Love. Clapping them cheeks.
All natural, right?
All natural.
TNA, 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 TNA.
All that's mine. Everything, yes. Mine.
Prove it.
Listen there. Where my money at?
I had to clap again.
Yes, sir.
You can't be dead.
Woo! Listen, we're not just calling it.
All natural, right?
All natural.
Yeah.
All right, so that was Sister Sola back in the day clapping them butt cheeks. Hey, ain't nothing wrong with clapping them cheeks. She's 35. She looks older than that. It's so Weez, I'm discrediting her because of that shit she said on the air. I'm discrediting that because it was ignorant as hell. I'm discrediting that because it was some real ignorant shit to say. And I just talked about this last week, how you get a lot of people who used to be in the game, then all of a sudden they pop up out of nowhere being real reckless whenever they come around black empowerment movements being real reckless. There's something, that's not a coincidence. I've talked about this many times on my show. I've exposed people who got fed charges and then all of a sudden they turn around and they're at some type of black empowerment rally or whatever, talking real loud, making a big ruckus, and talking real crazy and being disruptive. I just talked about this last week. There's another stripper trying to go after Brother Umar Johnson. I just did a show about this. So now we have another stripper coming on TV talking about I'm an angry black person, and then they're trying to represent for black folks and talking crazy as shit. These are not coincidences, family. Some of these people are paid to do that. And who better to do that than people who are part of some type of sex industry or part of the life, the game, or people who didn't get out the game, who didn't have an exit strategy. I did a whole show breaking that shit down. A lot of times when you get people who are older and they're out here in the game still, they didn't get an exit strategy. What happens is that they get like charges on them. They get like in a little trouble here. They got a couple of cases they want to get off their record. So now somebody on the top approaches them and say, okay, look, I can erase your record. I can get such and such out of jail. I can drop your Fed charge. I can do this. I can do that. But I need you to go to this little rally and hold up a sign. I need you to go to the little Black Power conference and kind of disrupt shit. I need you to have a relationship with such and such over here. I need you to get down with brother over here and kind of bust that movement up. They do it all the time. They did that with the Black Panthers. They would get go-go dances and all that to infiltrate the Black Panthers. Some of those women that used to be with the Black Panthers were ex-hoes and the whole shebang. So that's old shit they do, and they do it now. Well, it's a wheeze. Well, I'm going to tell you, it has something to do with me blocking you, because I'm about to block you and ban you out the room. There you go. That's what I'm doing. I'm blocking your ass. All right, what's up? Who's calling?
It's Joe.
What's up? Your name is Joe?
Yes, sir.
Where you calling from, Joe?
Rock Hill, South Carolina.
Oh, you calling from where, brother?
Rock Hill, South Carolina.
Oh, okay. You're in South Carolina. How far are you from Charleston?
Probably about 3 hours.
3 hours. Okay, what's on your mind, brother? It sound like you calling from a goddamn tin can, but your phone is real janky, but what's on your mind? Brother, I can't do it, brother. Brother, I can't hear you. Brother, your phone is too raggedy. I can't do it with the raggedy phone. You're going to have to get on your grandmama's landline or something and call me back, brother. I can't do it with the raggedy phones, family. It's 2015. Niggas are still calling from T-Mobile sidekicks and shit. I don't know what this brother's talking about. Get y'all phone game together. I don't know how there's raggedy phones in 2015, man. I just don't know. Don't forget, man, y'all get tickets to join me live in Philly, Atlanta, and Detroit this July. Get tickets at TariqLive.com right now. What's up? Who's calling?
Hey, what's up? It's Ernie.
Vernon?
Ernie.
Ernie?
Yes.
Ernie, okay, where you calling from, Ernie? I ain't seen a nigga named Ernie in about 20 years, nigga. What? Is that short for Ernest?
Yes.
Oh, I was about to say, okay. All right, Ernie, what's on your mind, brother?
Hey, man, first I wanted to just speak on that chick, that Solo Love chick, man.
Yeah.
Well, just in general, man, just really, yo, not a lot of black people are really qualified to speak for us like that, man. We got to chill on that, man. If you're not really, really spitting, yo, you really shouldn't be speaking publicly to a large group of people with the media if you're not really... educated like that. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly, exactly, man. Just running up in front of the camera, spewing dumb shit like that and talking in circles, that's defeating the whole cause, man. And again, that looks like some agent provocateur shit as far as I'm concerned.
Right, I feel you on that. But I wanted to get your question, I wanted to get your input on a coworker of mine. I got a white coworker who's expressed his like interest in helping black causes, but he basically breaks it down and says that everything is all based off of the economic structures and the fact that we don't have basically he's saying he's like a socialist, like he likes Karl Marx and all that, and he feels like that's the reason why we're all oppressed, like intersectionalism.
That ain't none but another white supremacist running a bunch of game on you.
That's all it is.
I know so. Whenever they start talking about, they will talk about everything except white supremacy. They start talking about, well, it's really socialism. Well, it's really capitalism. Well, it's really communism. All of that, those different isms, it's white supremacyism, it's racism. Because who are the socialists? Who are the socialists? Who are the capitalists? Who are the communists? Who are the people running those movements? These are white supremacists running these movements. They can never really articulate all of the socialism and all that stuff and what it means and how come black people seem to get the shorthand of the stick of this socialist society. You understand?
Right, I see. So what you think I should do, like, in terms of, like, should I, like, stay away from him?
Question
I
mean, him. I don't really what you do, anyway, what but. You do, you question him. Like, when he say it's socialism, okay, say, okay, explain, sir. What do you mean by socialism? How is socialism creating mass incarceration for all of these black people? And wait for his answer. What do you think he's going to say?
When I do hit him with that stuff sometimes, but I'm real cautious about going back and forth because, like, I'm not trying to have him run to HR or something either.
No. Asking questions. No. You're asking this brother questions, just like I'm asking you. For example, you be him and I'm you, okay? So answer me like you think he will answer. So you say the problem, sir, is not racism, but it's socialism?
Right. And he basically says, he's like, yeah, because he feels like the reason why the 1% has all the money and because they have all the money, then they don't have a reason to change anything else. Because the 1% has all the money, then they control everything. He said he feels like if it was evenly distributed amongst everyone, then it would be better.
Okay, well then ask him, so if the 1% are trying to control everyone, well, how come it's not people in the dominant white society who's being mass incarcerated, shot down by cops, the most unemployed, the people who are living in the most impoverished situations. If it's all about the 1%, how come so many people in the dominant society are not being as disenfranchised as black people? Just ask some real simple questions.
Okay.
Because it's going to always go back to race. Now, he's going to try to talk in circles and all that, but it's going to break down to race because still, talking about socialism and the 1% and all that, why are black folks on the bottom then? That doesn't answer.
Right.
White people and black people are not in the same boat. Black people are on the bottom as far as economics, work, labor, law, schooling, the whole nine. So explain that. Make him explain that. It's that simple.
Okay.
You feel me?
All right.
But don't let them run that Jedi. Don't let them run that Jedi mind trick about, well, it's not racism, it's socialism and capitalism and the Illuminati and all that old sick simple shit. You feel me?
Okay.
All right, Ernie.
All right.
Thanks for the call,
Ernie.
Yes, indeed. That is Ernie from what city did Ernie say he was from? That's Ernie. Ernie, is this you?
Boy, am I thirsty. Am I thirsty?
That reminded me of Sesame Street, a nigga named Ernie. That reminded me of Sesame Street. But we got to stop going for the Jedi mind tricks. All that Marxism and all that. These people are white supremacists, dude. These people are white supremacists. And these white supremacists, they love to talk in code and they love to deflect. They love talking in code and they love deflecting. Watch out for those deflections. Just like, and watch out for the codes too. It's like with this Dylan dude. You know, he had several pictures they found of Dylan. He had like the number 88. He's writing the number 88 in sand and the number 14. Now, for those who don't know, the number 88, that's the code word for Hell Hitler. So that's how white supremacists identify each other. Look out for the codes. Whenever you see a white person or suspected white supremacist with a two H's anywhere, you know, that's a sign for Hell Hitler, because H is the eighth number, the eighth letter in the alphabet. So they'll have two eights. So you got to watch that. Watch out for those eights, the number eight. Let me type that in. If you see the number 88, 88 stands for HH. All right. And also 14. Watch out for the number 14. You see a suspected white supremacist make reference to the letters 14. That's very significant to white supremacists, because that's there was a white supremacist leader. I can't think of his name, but he had a phrase called the 14 words that all white supremacists should use. David Lane is his name. His name is David Lane. He was the leader of a white supremacist organization, and the 14 words were basically, we must secure the existence of our people and a future for white children. Those are the 14 words. We must secure the existence of our people and a future for white children. Those are the 14 words, and this is what the white supremacists, that's their mantra and their goal. Their goal is to live by these 14 words. And the guy's name is David Lane. So y'all watch these codes. See, these white supremacists, they stay coded up. This is why I say we got to have a code of conduct. See, we don't have no code. They got all types of codes that we don't even know about. Most black folks don't even know about these little codes that these people have. And even some of these extremists. David Lane, that was his name. So these white supremacists, they get the number 14 and all that shit tattooed on them. So when y'all see Dylan, he's in the sand. He has the word, he has the letters 1488. That's what that means. 420, I understand the Hitler's birthday thing. That's why in April, I always warn people about April. I warn people about April every year, because April, the 20th, 420 of April, is not just a weed month. They look at it as the weed thing. But that's Hitler's birthday, and this is why a lot of white extremist attacks go off in April. And it's been going off, you know, even after April, but it gets real heavy in April. But this thing is real heavy, man. We got to get these codes of conduct cracking. We got to get these codes of conduct, and that's why I'm going on the Code of Conduct tour. Let me show you the flyer. All
right, hold on.
This is why it's important to come out to the Code of Conduct tour, family. Yeah, that's another thing. Get your tickets at TariqLive.com. But that's another thing. The whole 420 thing about weed and they legalizing weed and 420. Black folks need to stop co-signing that, because I think they specifically made the whole 420 weed thing on Hitler's birthday. I think they specifically made it for Hitler's birthday, and they're just still coding it up. They're hiding behind the code. So we got to understand these codes that people put out of cannabis culture and all that old shit. And there's a reason why, because the whole weed thing, it was supposed to be about them trying to legalize weed and all this old shit. But again, the white supremacists, they always work in codes that's going to benefit white supremacy. And black folks don't understand this stuff. Let me get a couple of calls here. What's up? Who's calling?
Hey, what's going on, Jerick, man? It's Cal from Montgomery once again. What's happening?
Where you from?
From Montgomery, Alabama.
There you go. What's on your mind, man?
Man, dude, first of all, I got to thank you for all that you do, man. And I just want to say, dude, I watched CNN, and about 5 minutes into that shit, I just turned it off, man. Because I'm like, at this point, when people walking into a sanctuary where older people couldn't defend themselves if you gave them 2 boxing gloves and shooting our grandparents.
Yeah.
We sitting here on fucking TV talking about we forgive. And then when you talk to the average black person just on the street, they're going to argue me down about the principles of Christianity. I'm like, man, it ain't about that. It's about y'all getting our fucking heads shot off, man. Like, yeah. How do we progress forward? And I'm going to get my ticket to go to, I see you in Atlanta, by the way.
But yes, indeed.
How do we progress forward? Like, what's man? Can you just drop knowledge, man? Like, what do we do, man?
Yeah, we're talking about that now, man. Thank you for the call. I'm going to address that right now. But like I said, man, we don't need to worry about these niggas who gave up. Because these, when you hear people talking about, after the, you see black folks' grandmothers get gunned down in a church, and your response is to talk about the principles of Christianity, those are niggas who are saying to you, I don't care what happens. I'm surrendering, and I'm just waiting on them to give me a nice, honorable, clean death. That's all they're saying. I'm just waiting on them to give me a nice, good, slow killing. Just don't make it too painful. That's all they're saying. They're surrendering. And they're trying to waste your time and come up with different excuses so they don't have to do nothing. So they like to argue and debate about bullshit and non sequiturs to waste time. That's all they're doing. Let's see who else is on the phone. What's up? Who's calling?
Hey, what's up, man? It's Spock.
Hey, what's going on with you, man?
Hey, I'm chilling. Hey, man, I got some solutions, man. I think that the solutions are in technology for a lot of the problems that we experience.
Okay, explain.
All right, so, you know, we got a lack of people that are in the programming and stuff like that, but virtually that's the answer to all of our problems. We can create digital currencies like Bitcoin, like call it the black coin, right?
Okay.
We can crowdfund each other. We can do all types of anything. We can form political parties if we wanted to do that, but we're moving more towards a global community.
Right.
And that's the thing, we're falling behind right now because black people are lacking in technology. You know, we make up less than 1% of the high ranking engineers and tech founders, and that's where all of the money is. Look at Mark Zuckerberg, 30 years old, worth $30 billion. What other industry they're doing that in? You know what I mean?
Right, right.
So my thing is, you know, we need mastermind groups, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know if you read Napoleon Hill, Think and Grow Rich, you know, books like that, but I'm into, so anyway, but, you know, I really believe in that mastermind principle.
Yeah.
I think if we come together and we start forming these mastermind groups and collectively come together and getting on some real mastermind stuff collectively.
Yeah.
You know. And making sure we hold each other accountable, because that's another thing I think is lacking is, you know, we don't have any accountability in our culture. We really need people to say, look, brother, what are you doing, man? Are you doing what is this equaling out to? You know what I mean?
And see, when we talk about accountability, see, that's why we got to get an economy, because the thing is, you make people accountable through punishing or rewarding them economically. That's how you do it.
Correct.
And we don't have that. We don't have an economy. So we can let coonishness and dumb shit run amok within the so-called black community, and they don't get punished. We can get people getting on TV yelling dumb shit, and they don't get punished because we don't have a mechanism as which to punish them. So that's something we need to work on. We need to get that economic thing. And you're right on the money about having a mastermind group. And that's what I do with the Hidden Colors series. I get all the best thinkers that I know of, put us all in the same venue, which is in a documentary film, and we talk about what's happening, what has happened, and what we need to do for the future. And then people gravitate towards that. Because one thing we do in black society, we have a thing where we try to put our thinking caps on and try to have think tanks, and then we got a bunch of dumbasses at the table interjecting their dumbass ideology. And that's cruel to say, but that's how you got to look at it. We try to bring too many folks to the table who are not really qualified to really be dialoguing about what we need to do as a solution. We got too many people who want to be seen, who's just in the mix to be seen. We got too many people who've been sent by the white supremacists. So we have too many people we got to look out for and watch our backs for to try to come to the table to dialogue with everybody. We do need that mastermind group to really say what we need to say. That's why I had the think tank going on. So everybody needs to do their job. And I'm not saying that a person who's not qualified as far as business expertise is a dumbass, but they shouldn't be at the table when we're trying to strategize about politics. We can utilize that person as a ground soldier. You understand? Everybody can play their positions. The thing is, you got certain people who are not qualified for certain positions trying to play positions that's out of their league. So you got a lot of people who would be best as foot soldiers trying to sit at the table, run things like a CEO, and everything falls all straight to hell. So we got to learn how to...
Chiefs, not enough Indians, right?
Exactly, absolutely. So that's another thing we need to do, and we're going to talk about that on the Code of Conduct tour, man.
Yeah.
But thank you for the call, so, family.
Yeah, I got one.
Okay, no, got to keep it short and sweet, brother. Got to keep it short and sweet, family. Got other calls coming in. But we got to learn how to play our part. And the thing is, man, in the black community, the white supremacists, like I said the other day, they've been testing us. They've been testing to see how far they can get away with stuff. They've been weakening us. They've been making us weak. They've been destroying the warrior class. They've made it so that we have a lot of young black men out here in skinny jeans doing the nay-nay, cooning on Instagram and Twitter and YouTube. When they see we got a whole plethora of young black males in skinny jeans with their feet out doing the nay-nay, they know they got us. They got the warrior class in a moist frame of mind. Niggas out here twerking. You understand? So now they know that they can come up in these communities and get real bold. They've been testing us. I was warning people when they were doing those open gun marches and walks in black neighborhoods. When I saw that and black folks were letting them do it, I'm like, y'all, man, these white supremacists are testing you out. Don't let them walk up in your neighborhood like that, doing these open marches like they're doing you some kind of favor. These white supremacists are testing you, walking in your communities with guns, seeing what they can get away with. Also, these little hood pranks they're doing. These little goofy white supremacists are coming in the neighborhood, pranking people with hood pranks and all that. They're testing you. Getting around you telling nigga jokes, and black folks are letting these little white supremacists get around them and say nigga all day. They've been testing you. Now that they know they got you in a weak, submissive, bitch-made position, now they go in for the kill, because now they can go in and shoot your grandmother and your moms and your dads and your children, because they know the men are not in a position to save them. The men are moist and twerking and doing the nay-nay. The men out here bullshitting. Ain't no warrior class. So we got to understand how this game is working out here, family. Y'all sitting around letting these white supremacists come around you acting like they're down saying nigga left and right, just like that coon in that video I played earlier. I'm pretty sure that Dylan was around him saying nigga all the time, and they just laughed it off. Yeah, he said nigger. You know, I guess they are niggers. This is a black dude. Yeah, I see black folks letting your little white friends call you nigga like it's the thing to do. I don't play with white supremacists like that. Let me see who we got on the phone. What's up? Who's calling?
Hey, Tariq.
Hey, what's up? Who's this?
My name's Chris. I'm from Arizona.
All right, Chris, you're white, black, you're white guy, black guy. You sound like you're white.
Yeah, I'm white.
Okay, what's on your mind, bro?
I wanted to know, you mentioned earlier that there was a laundry list of things that, you know, that white people can do.
Oh, yes.
And I just wanted, like, I emailed you, and I wanted to, you know, I just wanted to get the opportunity to maybe get that list.
Okay. Now, did I correspond with you on the email?
No, I would. I haven't been able to do your show, like, in a live thing. I've been watching you on YouTube.
Okay.
So, like, this is the first time, and I found your email, and then you were, like, accepting calls, and I'm really nervous. Sorry. I didn't expect you to pick up.
Right. Well, no need to be nervous. So you would like to help out. So, now, what are some of the things you would like to do, first of all? Because I have a laundry list, but I would like to know where your head is right now. What are some of the things you would like to do to help out in the situation? And how do you identify the problem in the situation that we're in? How do you identify it?
Well, I guess for your first part, I would think, you know, me, I'm a white person. I don't think that I would really get too far going into a black community trying to do anything. You know what I mean?
Right.
But they, you know, there's you. You are obviously speaking, you know, as far as what I know, you know, like, you're the best guy I've heard on the internet, you know, like, you have real ideas that, you know, you don't seem like you're a hateful person.
Not at all.
You just want to build up your own race.
Right.
You want to, you know, you want to work the problems. And I figure, you know, maybe I could find something from that list that I could do, you know, around white people. You know, I'm going to be a teacher here soon enough when I get my degree.
Right.
And there's going to be young people that are going to be looking to me. I don't want to give them the history of the United States and then be like, it's all fucked up. Here you go.
Right.
You know what I mean? There's got to be some kind of solution. And I just thought, like, you're the only one that I would listen to personally, because I have found a lot of people that are just like, you know, they go for the extermination of white people. And I don't know. I guess I can't roll with that. So.
Right. And so the thing is, you do acknowledge that the problem is systematic white supremacy. You do acknowledge that, right?
I was sitting there listening to your show the other night, and the thing that really keeps going over my mind is that's what I liked mostly about you. Is you were like, it's a system of systematic white supremacy. We need to replace it with a system of justice and minimize conflict. And when I think about you, I think, wow, That's the best thing I've heard.
Right. Now, so what I need you to do, since you agree with that and you want to do your part to not be a white supremacist and help out with promoting justice and bringing justice, what we need you to do, number one, go through the white community as a white guy, because we don't need you to do anything in the black community. That's kind of useless. But in the white community, we need you to go around law enforcement. We need you to go around politicians. We need you to be our spy to let us know who the white supremacists are. That's number one. You understand?
Okay.
That's the number one thing, because the white supremacists usually like to hide. We need you to run intel. We need you to wear wires. We need you to record secretly their little conversations about how they don't like blacks and how they're going to do this to black. They say that all the time, and as a white person, you know that there are white people who make racist jokes all the time. So we need you to be our version of Jesse Lee Peterson. We need you in the white community getting intel on who the white supremacists are. That's one thing. All right?
All right.
Now, number two, we need you, after you get some of this information, we need you to go public and start saying that black people need to be financially compensated for systematic white supremacy disenfranchising them. We need you to scream that out loud as a white guy. Got it?
Okay.
All right. So now when you do those two things first, get back with me and then I can let you know what else to do. But those are the first two things. All right?
All right.
My man. So email me when you get some of those things done and then we're going to go back to business. Thank you for the call. All right. So when he does that, then we get on, holler at me. We need him to be a whistleblower. All right? Let's start there. We need him to be our a white version of Crispy. We need a white Crispy. That's what we need. We need a white Crispy coon. That's going to be our coon. All right? We need us a white coon. He's our version of Crispy. We need to shave his little hairline back, make his little white skin ashy, and go out there and infiltrate white society for us. That's what Wispy. That's what we need. Somebody said Wispy. He needs to be Wispy. We got Crispy. We need Wispy. All right, so we need you to work as Wispy, the white Crispy, to let us know who these white supremacists are. Tell on them. That's what we need. Man, that's all we need. We need you to infiltrate white society. All right, Operation Wispy. That's what we need. Operation Wispy. All right, let's see who we got here. All right, what's up? Who's calling? Hello? All right, let's try again. Let's try again. Hey, what's up? Who's calling?
Hey, Tariq. How are you?
Hey, love. Who is this?
This is Deja.
Deja. Where are you calling from, Deja?
I come from Dallas.
Deja from Dallas. What's on your mind, love?
Okay. I'm not going to take a single serious time. I just want to ask you something.
Go ahead, sweetie. Deja? Deja? Did her nigga take her phone?
Oh, I'm sorry. Can you hear me?
Okay. Did your man smother you? What happened, Deja? Who the hell that is on the phone? I hear some bass in the phone. Hold on. Who is that nigga? Hold on.
He actually does get upset because I like to listen to you. And I was like cracking up like, hi, Tariq. And he's like, I don't know why you listen to him anyway. Like, but anyway.
Hate ass nigga. Go ahead.
I just wanted to ask you, like, okay, how can a woman, like, protect her finances in her marriage? Because my husband told me before that if I don't contribute to the house, I need to get out. And he's like always trying to count my money pretty much. Like I make more money than he does. And he's just always been like, if you don't contribute, we're not going to have a house. We're not going to have this. We need to put our finances together. And I be contributing to the house. I just don't, you know, join our finances together. And I think that bothers him. Like he wants, you know, pretty much to be able to access my money. And I'm not allowing that. So, and it's really causing a problem with us. So I don't know, like, what advice you have about you know, that.
How long you been, y'all married, right?
Yeah, we're married.
How long y'all been married?
We've been married for about 6 months, 7 months now.
Oh, this shit is new. Okay, okay.
Yeah.
Damn.
Yeah.
How long have you known him?
I've known him for about a year and a half, so like 2 years.
Oh, so it's relatively new. Y'all just really getting to know each other. Okay. Yeah. Don't let this nigga get access to your money. I can tell already just by the hater energy that the nigga got. Don't let this nigga get access to your paper. This sounds like a nigga trying to get on that come-up game and trying to flip it like, okay, you ain't bringing none to the table. No, no. It sounds like that nigga's trying to get your little tangibles so that he can try to ball out or whatever. So I would say, hey, you still getting to know this dude. And, you know, you got to be kind of protective of what you got just in case this dude try to wipe you out and then make you bounce or whatever. You don't really know this dude like you should. So
yes, right, because I work hard. Like I'm always studying. I'm always trying to start a business. I'm always trying to advance myself. And he don't really quite do much of that. So he's always like, oh, your head's gonna pop. You always reading something. You always, you know, trying to study something. Your head's gonna blow up.
Don't let this nigga downgrade you. You got you a nigga that you trying to upgrade, and what happens, these niggas try to downgrade you. and niggas don't want to read and want to criticize you for reading and upgrading yourself. Don't let this nigga fuck your little financial game up. And I understand in black relationships, you know, we have to compromise a lot because, you know, we live in a system of white supremacy that creates a system of economic deprivation. I get that.
Yeah.
But you don't want no dusty ass nigga in here that's going to really sabotage what you got going on because they're miserable with their current situation. You dig?
Yeah, because I'm like, how am I supposed to respect you as a man and you always trying to count my money? Like, you need to be trying to make a home for us and our future family. Like, you shouldn't even be worried. I don't count nobody's money.
Right.
I just try to do me, try to do what I got to do. But he's always looking at it like, if I don't do this, we ain't going to have this. So you need to put your money with me. That way we can get a house. That way we can do this. I'm like, well, what do I need you for as a husband? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, right. You don't want no Jody from Baby Boy ass nigga. You dig? How old is dude? How old is he?
He's 26 now. He's about to be 27.
Now, how old are you?
I'm 26.
Oh, okay. So same.
And I have a degree and he doesn't. So he's always trying to throw it in my face like, oh, you think because you have a degree. And I'm like, I don't care about that. Like, I'm all about what are you trying to do? I mean, he's been trying to do stuff. But at the same time, he's not going at it like real hard like I am.
Yeah,
and he almost makes me feel guilty for trying to get, you know, something. And he's always trying to make me feel guilty for
that. Don't feel guilty for elevating yourself because that's one of them kind of niggas who don't want to do anything, get no tangibles. But in the bedroom, he's licking your booty hole and all this old shit, making you stay and all that. That's because that sounds like the only reason you down with a nigga like this. He be licking you good. Is this him right here? Mm-hmm. Hold on. Is this him? Hold on. Hold on. Yeah, that nigga be licking his half of the rent. When rent time come up, this nigga get to licking. Yeah, y'all better let these dusty niggas go, man. Dude, these niggas gonna try to lick up they half of the rent. Come on, sisters, y'all gotta stop falling for the lick for rent niggas. Y'all gonna fuck around with these lick for rent niggas and be on your ass. Come on, y'all. Man. Let me see who we got. We got an L.A. person. What's up? Who's calling?
Hey, what's good? Tariq, just get to see Johnson, man, from L.A.
Hey, man, what's going on with you, fam?
How's it going on, brother? Just touching base with you, man. Just want to chop it up about all this white supremacy that's going on, man, out here.
Yes, sir.
Go ahead. Crazy, man. The main thing that's really, like, getting to me, man, is that mainly black people right now, because they are so forgiving.
Yeah.
And they're just thinking like, okay, we know it's white supremacy, but that's, we still shackled. We don't know how to get free from that. So yeah. They go around and they say, oh, we forgive them. We embrace them. And then what happens next? This time next year, it's going to be the same shit.
Same thing.
Like how you said, every time around this time, it's another situation that's going on here. Throw a smoke screen up about, oh, it's a white person over here trying to act black. And now you have it over here. They coming in, shooting, taking us out.
Yes, indeed. Know? Yes, indeed.
But that code of conduct, man, it's right on time, man.
We need it, man. We really need it, man. But thank you for the call, brother. Yeah, man, we are so off code, brothers and sisters, man. We really need a code of conduct and a way of thinking and a way of doing business and a way of acting and interacting with each other. Because we don't necessarily have to so-called get together. Get together and do what? We got to have a code once we get together. We don't even need to get together for the code. We can just have it. That's why I want to talk about that on the Code of Conduct tour. It's very important that y'all come out. You need to fly in from Dallas to Atlanta, Chicago to Detroit. Y'all need to hit these cities up. Go to TariqLive.com and get your tickets now. And also, if you don't have the Hidden Colors films, go to HiddenColorsFilm.com to get Hidden Colors 1, 2, and 3. But we do things so off code, and everything we do is so plantation-minded, it's not even funny. You know, right when the day Well, the day after the shooting in Charlotte, there was another video that came out because black folks started making videos and did all types of stuff. There was one young lady who made a video. And I'm going to play some of the video here. This shows you our mindset. Right, not even more than 24 hours after the people were shot, this female who runs this website called Beyond Black and White, where it's a black girl who tries to promote black women getting with white men and all this old stuff. Right after the Charlotte shooting, the massacre, this sister makes a video talking about, well, will this interfere with white men dating black women? Do you know how coonish and how much of a damn bedwench? Some of this stuff, man, when I see this stuff, sometimes I just want to give up. Sometimes the bedwenching and the cooning, it kind of makes me want to throw in the towel every now and then. But when I see the kids, look at this video. I want y'all to see this. Now, this woman, she disabled the comments on her thing. She's up here with a scarf on her head looking like she done hopped off a box of pancakes. Now, this is the mindset of black folks after the people ain't even buried yet. Black folks then got shot in a church, and this is your mindset.
Hey, y'all. It's your girl, Who Swirls, Chris Carrison from Beyond Black and White, coming at you with some serious commentary. There's been a lot of talk on the Beyond Black and White website on our fan pages about the recent events in Charleston, South Carolina, in which a 21-year-old complete maniac entered one of Charleston's most historic black churches and killed 9 people, 6 black women and 3 black men. And from all indicators that we see, it's really no question that this is a hate crime. And I'll get to a little bit more about how that impacts interracial relationships later on in just a second. So we're all trying to figure out why. Why did he do this? There are reports that Dylan, while shooting people, said, you're raping our women. There's too many of you. You've got to go. Yet he killed 6 black women. And I'm scratching my head trying to figure out where the news reports of black women raping white women. I just am not seeing.
Let me pause it right here. Let me pause it right here for 1 minute. So she's scratching her head because they shot black women. Because she thought being a bedwench is going to save black women. If I be a bedwench and throw these black men under the bus, surely they'll spare us. Surely they will spare the bedwenches and the black women if we just suck enough white dick and throw these Negroes under the bus, these black men. They're going to spare us. Now that they're shooting black women, I'm scratching my head. Why? Because they put all of us in the same boat. They put all of us in the same boat. Let me continue.
I'm just not seeing that. But what I saw on the fan page was a lot of emotions and a lot of people making making sweeping decisions. And, I understand that all of this is based in people just really feeling pain and feeling like they're not being understood. So I want to talk with the white men who are listening to me right now, who are involved in black women, whether you're married or you're seeing someone, or you've got a girlfriend. I want you to look at this video before you talk to her about what happened at Charleston today, and it just may save your relationship. Now, I don't know how much all of you know about the civil rights movement and black American history. But this event has special significance to us in the black community. what Dylan, what this man did, has symbolic significance. Back during the civil rights.
Now look at what she just said. First, I don't know too much about Black history, but this situation has symbolic significance. I don't know what it is. So now she's trying. Now that the war is on, they're attacking Black women. Now they want to kind of jump over here on the Black side a little bit for protection. You understand? Now, whenever the Negro bedwinches, whenever they get under fire, all of a sudden they want to kind of mosey on over to the Black side a little bit. Y'all remember the Negro bedwinch out here in L.A.? When her white boyfriend, he's out there fingering her in a car and all this old shit, and then the cops came. Like, hey, what are you doing? Somebody called the police on you. What you doing? Oh, because I'm Black. Now she want to play the Black role. So when shit gets hot on them, now they want to ease on over to the Black side a little bit. Just a little bit. Just long enough to get protected so they can go run back to white daddy.
Movement. Hate groups like the KKK would bomb churches, kill little girls going to churches, bomb houses. Basically, it was to send a message that where you think you're safe, you're not. Where you think you can find peace, you won't. Where you think you are sheltered and protected, you are not. That is the message that white supremacists and white terrorists were trying to communicate during the civil rights era. So what we see that happened yesterday is reminiscent of what happened during those times. So what you may be sensing from many Black women who are outraged by this, rightfully, is a visceral reaction based on that historic knowledge that this is what people did to instill terror in our people. So when you come into the situation and you minimize it by saying, well, we don't have all the facts yet, or, all crime is a hate crime, and, you know, this isn't about race, this is about a crazy person who did an act of terror. All of that is really assholey behavior. I'm just gonna be honest.
Did y'all hear? So basically, just really listen to what she's saying. Just listen to what she's saying. She's basically saying, okay, white supremacists that I'm sitting up here having sex with, could you be a little more sensitive about being a white racist while I'm having sex with you? Can you be a little more sensitive? Because you know you're laying up with a damn white supremacist, but now you want them to be a little more sensitive about their white supremacy. Now you want them to be a little more sensitive about being a white supremacist towards you. Now that some sisters then got shot, you want them to not be so assholey about their white supremacy.
That is the reaction of a total unempathetic jerk. I don't care what color you are. And this is why it's important to have some sort of cultural understanding of the people that you're dating, so that you don't walk into situations where you're saying dumb stuff, ignorant things, because you have no...
No, sweetie, they're not dumb and ignorant. They mean what they say. Sweetie, if you're listening, they're not dumb and ignorant. When they say all that, we need to see the facts and they deserve it. No. They're speaking from the heart. You think because they got your Black coochie in their mouth that they somehow transcended race, and they did not. You're the bed wench. See, they didn't downgrade to your level. You dig? And you didn't upgrade to theirs. they still have a slave bedwinch mentality with you, and they keep their white supremacist views. And y'all sitting up here trying to convince your white daddies to not have a white supremacist mindset towards you, and they still have it. It ain't about you trying to teach them to not be ignorant. They're speaking from the heart. This is why I go in on these Negro bedwinches. They're embarrassing, man. They're embarrassing, dude. That's why no love or respect for them. Their whole thing right now is trying to get the people they're bedwinching for to just be a little, don't be so cold and don't be so ignorant with your racism. It hurts my feelings. Well, that's what being a bedwinch is about.
Reference. So, white guys, if you know, to approach the issue in Charleston and to minimize it or to dismiss it as not racism or try to debate about the reasons or the level of evil this was is not going to get your girlfriend to want you to sleep next to her tonight or your wife to sleep next to you tonight. She's going to be mad as hell at you, and I can understand why, because you're not making the effort to understand the historical significance of why the shooting.
I'm done. That's it. I can't play. This is kind of a long thing. I can't play no more, man. If you're too racist, I'm not going to have sex with you at night for this night. Not tomorrow, I will. But if you're too racist, white daddy, that's not going to want to make me. No. She didn't say she wouldn't do it, by the way. Listen to the wording. Listen to the wording. It's not going to want to make me want to. I'll still do it, but I ain't going to want to do it because I'm a bedwinch. I ain't really got a choice. But that's not going to really want me. I'm not going to be into it, white daddy. If you're racist and mean to me, I'm not going to moan with your white cock in my mouth. I'm not going to moan when I do it. I'm not going to cuff your balls like I used to. So if you're mean, I'm just not going to be into it. I'm not going to want to be there. Fuck. When I saw this, man, because the day of the shooting, man, the next day, because I was doing international press. I mean, I'm just going in on white supremacy. I'm just giving white supremacy the business. And when I see this type of shit, I'm like, God damn. It's like when you're out here fighting, you're getting it in, and you see coons and bedwinches working behind the scenes against your efforts of progress. It's like, we gotta do something about the coons and the bedwinches, man. That's why we gotta empower ourselves, man. You got people whose bodies are still warm from getting murdered, and people's first instinct is to really convince their white supremacist mates to not be so racist around them. Forget about empowering yourself. White daddy, can you not be so insensitive with your racism? I know you're a racist, but can you not be so insensitive? Ah, damn, man. The Negro bedwinch mentality is real. The Negro bedwinch mentality is real, man. That woman right there ain't got nothing to do with black women at all. She does not represent black women whatsoever. Thankfully, most black women got way more sense than that. That woman does not represent the black female collective. The Negro bedwinch will slit your throat as a black woman. They hate other black women. My God, the Negro bedwinch, man. Now y'all see why I go in on them, dude. They're dangerous. They are dangerous. Them and the coons are neck and neck with their danger. What's up? Who's calling?
Hey, this is Keith from New York.
Keith from New York. How you doing, fam?
I'm good. I wanted to talk about the guy's manifesto, and I wanted to say that was a good lesson in white supremacy. And it let black people know that this isn't some form of ignorance.
you know, like these white supremacists are very articulate in what they're saying.
Yeah.
And I noticed that they're trying to make it like now they're trying to talk about taking down the Confederate flag. Like,
right.
That's just a symbolic gesture, and it's avoiding a systematic change.
Right. Right. Yeah. There's a lot. We got to get together and we got to talk about what we need specifically, because black folks, we have never really discussed what we need and what we want specifically, because we get all splintered up. And that's because of the white supremacists. So we have to get a common agenda. We've never had a common agenda. And that's one of the problems. We don't ask for nothing, so we don't get shit. We want hugs. We want pats on the heads. And the white supremacists, they come down and give it to us. We want white daddy to have sex with us. We want white mommy to have sex. And we cool with that. We got to get off that buck bedwinch mentality, man. We got to get off that shit. And we got to get a code of conduct. Thanks for the call, fam. Because they give you what you want. Let's just be real. They give you what you want. Whatever you want, you will get. Whatever you want, you will get. If we wanted real economic empowerment, we would get it if we really wanted it. Enough black folks don't want it. Enough black folks don't want it, but we want what that woman in this video I just played want. A lot of women want white daddy. You want to sit up and watch Scandal and be the next Olivia Pope and let white daddy sit up and talk to you like you're a goddamn slave and make nigga jokes around you. And you sitting up giggling until you see black women get shot up too. Thinking that you were going to be safe, and now you want white daddy to be a little more sensitive. Come on, white daddy. Those weren't just those niggas getting... It just wasn't them niggas like Mike Brown, because y'all love to get on TV talking about Mike Brown deserved it, and Trayvon deserved it, and all these black people deserved it. So now elderly black women are getting shot, and white daddy is still talking reckless. So now what you going to say? Because you know it can happen to you now. The shit is getting real out here. Now, come on, white daddy. You know, black people, we've had a struggle. I don't know what it is because I don't give a fuck about black people in history, but we have had a struggle. Come on, y'all playing with this thing, man. Y'all playing with it. Oh, yeah, taking slave pictures with these people, like that politician out there on the East Coast taking slave pictures with his bedwench. Come on, family. Anyway, fam, let me get up out of here, y'all. Go to TariqElite.com. Get that fresh gear, www.TariqElite.com. Get that fresh gear right now, family. TariqElite.com, www.TariqLive.com. That's where you can go get tickets to join me. I'm telling you. Y'all need to be on the Code of Conduct tour with me, because we are going to have a question and answer so you can give some of your opinions. And I'm telling y'all, be articulate when you come out. Don't get on the mic and be talking crazy. We want you to come out. I want you to come out and join me. I will be in Philly, Atlanta, Detroit. If you are in New York, if you are in Rhode Island, if you are in Jersey, if you are in Baltimore, come up to Philly July 5th. I'm coming to Atlanta July 11th. If you're in South Carolina, everybody in South Carolina need to come down to Atlanta on July 11th for my lecture, the Code of Conduct Tour. If you're in Texas, come to Atlanta July 11th. If you're in Memphis, come to Texas July 11th. Come to Atlanta July 11th. If you're in Florida, come to Atlanta July 11th. If you're in Alabama and Mississippi and Louisiana, come to Atlanta July 11th. If you are in Chicago, if you are in Milwaukee, come to Detroit July 18th for my lecture. Y'all come on out, family. Get tickets again at TariqLive.com. Put the link up one more time. Everybody, I want to see your face in the place. This is an important lecture tour. Everybody need to come on out. We're going to have a real deep conversation, family. Nothing out here yet, but again, because when I get back from this lecture tour, I'm going to start working hard and finishing up on the Hidden Colors 4 documentary. I'm filming actually tomorrow. I'm filming a brother named Robin Walker. I flew him in from London. I'm filming this brother. This brother's bad. So we're still filming Hidden Colors 4 as we speak. So I want you guys to come see me, these tour dates. This is going to be the last time I'm doing a tour in a while because I got to finish working on Hidden Colors 4 and I got to get really deep in that. So everybody need to come out to the Code of Conduct Tour. Here's the flyer again, family. All right, I'm out. Happy Father's Day.